Good morning, everybody, and welcome to the online service for Hillbank Church in Dundee, in the Hilltown area of the city. If you're new to us, my name's Matty, and I'm one of the elders at Hillbank. And we're so thrilled that you've chosen to tune in this morning, and we hope this service is a blessing to you wherever you are. We hope you're coping well as we live with yet another week of lockdown. We're edging closer to our one-year anniversary of our first online service, which is very sobering to consider. But we recognise that God is faithful, that he is with us and he is for us. We see that in the person of Jesus Christ. And our opening hymn today speaks about how we can approach God. Before the throne of God above, I have a strong and perfect plea. Only reason we can approach God this morning, wherever we are in our homes or wherever we're watching this, wherever we are, whatever stage of life we're in, the reason we can approach is God with confidence. Our plea, as it were, is the one who loved us and gave his life to save us. Later on today, we'll be considering some words from the book of Exodus and a story from many thousand years ago in the life of God's people, the nation of Israel. But for now, we'll open with this hymn, Before the Throne of God Above. In a moment, we'll have God's word read to us by Frankie Burt, looking at passages from both Exodus and 2 Corinthians. But first, Fiona Robertson, one of the members here at Hillbank, is going to lead us in a time of prayer.
Good morning. We've come to the point in our service where we pray for others, in our community, in our church, and in our nation. Today, I would like us to pray for those in our city who are homeless. Dundee City Council has seen a steep rise in the number of people declaring themselves homeless during the past difficult year. And figures at the end of 2020 revealed around 600 homeless people in Dundee alone. We thank God for organisations such as Eagle's Wings and Dundee Parish Nursing, who work in our city with the homeless and they've worked together through all the lockdown period to provide for the homeless in our city. I would also like to remember our government today at this very difficult time, both nationally and in Scotland. Let us pray. Father, we come before you at the start of a new week, and we thank you for walking with us through these difficult days. We bring before you the work of Eagle's Wings and Parish Nursing, and thank you that this work has been able to continue during the past year. We pray for all the staff who give tirelessly to this work, that you would continue to give them daily strength to keep going with this such necessary work. But we pray most of all for the people they come into contact with. In addition to providing food and much needed advice, we pray for the conversations that take place and the opportunities to spread the love of Jesus to those in need. We pray also for safety for those who are involved in this work as they go out into the streets of Dundee. We thank you also for the food banks in Dundee, who have seen a big increase in people seeking their help. We pray for the resources for this work, that it may be able to continue. Father, we pray today for our government, for Boris Johnston and for Nicola Sturgeon in all the difficult decisions that they have to make at this time. We pray for wisdom for them as the nation starts to see a little light at the end of this long, dark tunnel, Lord, with the possibility of the easing of lockdown restrictions. We pray that our government ministers might know when the time is right for that. We pray for our schools as they look to reopen, and we pray that our children may soon be back in their classrooms with the routine of school life again. We pray for our churches, Lord, as we look forward to them reopening and the possibility of having face-to-face time with each other in church again. Lord, again, we just pray for wisdom for the timing of this to be right. We give all this to you, Father, and we pray for our government at this time. And now, Father, as we go into a new week, we pray you will go with us and that each of us may put the love of Jesus at the centre of all that we do and say. And all this we do ask in Jesus' name, Lord. Amen.
Good morning, Church. I greet you all in the glorious and treasured name of our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ. And I pray the reading of God's word today will be a blessing to us all. The readings are from the New King James Version, and the first reading is Exodus chapter 16, verses 1 to 3. And they journeyed from Elim, and all the congregation of the children of Israel came to the wilderness of Sin, which is between Elim and Sinai, on the 15th day of the second month after they departed from the land of Egypt. Then the whole congregation of the children of Israel complained against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. And the children of Israel said to them, "Oh, that we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by pots of meat and when we ate bread to the full. For you have brought us out into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger." The second reading is from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 14 and 15. "For the love of Christ compels us, because we judge thus, that if one died for all, then all died. And he died for all, that those who live should live no longer for themselves, but for him who died for them and rose again. Amen."
Most of us are probably quite familiar with the phrase, the grass is greener on the other side. The idea that there's more enjoyment and life and fulfillment to be found in what someone else has or what other people are experiencing than what we have or are living with just now. Today we're going to consider how that can be a temptation and a way of thinking that Christians can perhaps fall into. Let's go back to our first reading that Frankie shared with us from the book of Exodus. Exodus, of course, is a book all about God's people, Israel or the Hebrews, being liberated from their lives as slaves in Egypt. So these are people who have been through an awful lot by the time we get to Exodus chapter 16. And they've been through an immense level of suffering. Hard for us really to get our heads around today just how awful it would have been to have been a Hebrew slave living in Egypt at the time of the Exodus. At a time where the king, the Pharaoh as it were, has this open policy where if a Hebrew boy is born, he must be thrown into the River Nile. You're living in these labor camps that are known for their brutality, and we see this in the early chapters of Exodus. And it's no wonder to us that the people cry out to their God. They cry out to God that he would bring an end to this. And the story of Exodus really is about the God who hears their cries and steps in to rescue them. As I'm sure many of us are familiar, Moses steps into the story. Moses is raised up to be the man who would lead the people out of slavery in Egypt. And we have these plagues that God sends one after another until Pharaoh finally relents and lets the people go. And then they come to the Red Sea and Pharaoh's army are chasing after them and God parts the Red Sea. And Israel have made it to the other side on dry land, whereas the Egyptian army are destroyed. And just before this chapter, in chapter 15, we see the song of the redeemed, this hymn of praise, this worship song of praise from Moses and Miriam as they rejoice that their God is the God who saves, the God who destroys their enemies. That's chapter 15. And where we pick up in chapter 16, a couple of weeks have passed and there's a slightly different vibe in the air because the people are hungry. They've left slavery. They're on their way to the promised land, the land of Canaan that God had promised them. But first comes the wilderness. And the wilderness, the years in the desert, are quite disorientating. In the wilderness, it's quite easy to forget the amazing things that God has done in the past. And it's hard to remember the good things that God has promised for you in the future. In the wilderness, it can be very easy to lose perspective on where you've come from and where you're going so that you only see the immediate situation that you're facing up to in that moment. And that is what happens here in chapter 16. Read in verse 3, the people moan to Moses and say, if only we died by the Lord's hand in Egypt. There we sat around pots of meat and ate all the food we wanted. But you've brought us out into this desert to starve this entire assembly to death. As the story goes on, God gives them food to eat, but they get fed up of it. So in Numbers chapter 11, a little bit further on in the story, it says, the rabble with them began to crave other food. And again, the Israelites started wailing and said, if only we had meat to eat. We remember the fish we ate in Egypt at no cost. Also the cucumbers, melons, leeks, onions, and garlic. You see the things that the wilderness does to your mind. Because consider the way that they are thinking about and reminiscing about their old life as slaves. Their memories have gone a bit strange, haven't they? They're misremembering things here. They don't seem to remember the suffering and the agony and the crying out in desperation that God would set them free and take them out of the land. Now they're so overwhelmed by their immediate problems that they're facing in that moment that they start to think differently about what their life was like as slaves. And he started to think things like, well, you know, slavery wasn't great, you know, and you know all the beatings and the forced labor and the evil dictator who ruled over us and the way we were treated and the genocide amongst our own people and our newborn babies getting chucked into the river. Sure, slavery had its problems, but the garlic was legit. The fish was delicious. It was fantastic. Come and think about it. See, when you think of it that way, was slavery really that bad? I wish I was there right now. It's better than this anyway. The wilderness will do that to you. It will pull your eyes away from the miracles that God has done in your life, from the hand that he stretched out to set you free. And it all gets forgotten very easily. You easily forget the God who saved you. See, the thing about Israel was that they had seen, as we've considered already, they had seen the hand of God work amongst them. They'd sung the song of praise to their Lord, the rescuer. They'd gone from desperation to delight, but now all that's forgotten. And I wonder if us in our Christian life, if you are a Christian this day, if we can maybe relate to this in some way. You see, if we are in Christ, then we know a rescue that is far greater than anything that Israel experienced with the Red Sea and all the rest of it. We were completely separated from God in our sin. We were, as the Bible tells us, slaves to sin, under the eternal wrath of a God who had every right to judge us and every reason to condemn us. And yet the good news, the gospel message, speaks of the God who came to this earth, Jesus Christ, that we might be saved and rescued and belong to him. Jesus came and died in our place and rose again, that we might turn to him for forgiveness of sins and newness of life as his followers on this earth, and know eternal life in his name. And if you're a Christian this day, then you have, in one way or another, tasted in the greatest rescue mission of all time. Greater than Exodus or any other story you can think of. That's your story. That's your tale to tell. You have the identity of a rescued one, redeemed, purchased, saved by Jesus, by the blood of Christ on the cross. And the promise of the gospel is that one day we will enter a promised land of our own, where all things are made new, and sorrow and suffering are no more, and we will enjoy the daily presence of our King in perfect peace forever. That's where we've come from as slaves to sin. That's where we're going, eternal life in Christ Jesus. But we're not there yet. We've seen where we've come from, we've seen where we're going to, but for now we live in the middle. And like Israel, who wandered for 40 years in the wilderness, we too will have to live a Christian life in this world that will very often feel like a life of wilderness. The Christian life, as many of you know, has its ups and downs, but it very much includes times of wilderness. Times where, for one reason or another, we lose perspective on things. We lose sight of what God's done for us, and we don't live each day in the joy of the Lord who saved us and who's preparing a place for us. The eyes of our heart can very easily drift away from the promises of God. And maybe some of you are in that place just now, and you've forgotten the joy of your salvation, and you've forgotten what it is to truly worship the Lord with joy. You've maybe lost sight of what's to come in the future, and you've forgotten what God did for you in the past, and maybe you can't even remember the last time you truly worshipped God or felt any true affection for him. And maybe you're at risk of believing the same kind of lies that Israel fell for. You see, we know that Satan is a liar. We know the devil's a liar. And his lies will very often consist of two particular lies. One lie he tells is a lie that he tells to God about us. He tells lies to God about you and I. And then the other lie to consider is that he tells lies to you and I about God. Firstly, the lies that he tells to God about you and I, they are accusing lies. We know Satan is the great accuser. He will say to God and speak to God and say about you and I, this person isn't worth saving. That man, that woman isn't worth dying for. They're pretty useless. You should see the stuff they get up to when they're not at church or with their Christian friends. Don't even bother with them. They are hopeless. They're goners. Always accusing. But on the other hand, he tells lies to you and I about God. And if you think about it, that's really how the whole story began in Genesis 3. Where we see God has created the world, and he creates out of joy and love, and he brings Adam and Eve to life in this glorious creation, this stunning garden, and he gives them the land to enjoy. God is lavish, and he blesses, and he's generous. And what is the job of the serpent? What's Satan's job in the Garden of Eden? His job, as it always is to convince the people that God is the complete opposite of what he actually is. And so he convinces Adam and Eve, no, God is out to get you. He wants to hold you back. He is stingy. And his lie to them, as it is to us, is that if you really want to know life and fulfillment and joy and freedom, then stay away from God. If you're looking for your soul to be nourished, don't bother turning to God. That is the last place you want to go to if you're looking for freedom. That is the lie of the enemy. And it's what keeps many people from coming to God and coming to faith in Christ. But I wonder how convincing we might find it, even if we've been Christians for a long time. I wonder. You see, in our wilderness moments in the Christian life, I wonder if he might just throw these same type of lies in our direction, lies that make you think, just like Israel of old, that the old life, our old lives of what the Bible calls slavery, it wasn't really that bad, was it? Is a Christian life really better than the slavery you used to live through? Is this freedom that Christians brag about, is it really all that free? And do you honestly feel more liberated as a Christian, or are you just going along with what everyone else says and saying what you think you're supposed to say? All the while in this part of the world, we're being bombarded with this notion that religion and being part of a church is so oppressive and it's holding you back. And being a Christian's like having a ball and chain on your ankles. It's hampering your freedom. Why not just turn your back off it all? Turn your back away from it all, you know? Break off the shackles of religion. All these rules, these things that you can't do, things that you're missing out on, all the guilt and pressure of trying to look like a good Christian and not a complete phony and failure. Is it really worth it? And maybe like the Israelites, longing for their garlic and cucumber, we maybe start to think that there's more joy to be found in the old life, in the ways of the world, the ways that other people are living. I mean, was it really all that bad? Would God really be all that bothered if I went down this path in life? And if he would be bothered, and if he is bothered, then do I really want to trust him if he's just out to ruin my fun in that way? Would he be bothered if I went on that website or drank this or went to that, said this, gossiped about that person, slept with that person, lived in this type of way? Christianity doesn't let us do anything. You think maybe before we were saved, it was easy to do some of this stuff, and did it really do us any harm? These are the lies that Satan tells. And before we know it, we're longing for the life of slavery that we've left, just like Israel longed for their garlic and cucumber. Satan will do anything to twist our understanding of God. He wants to make the God of life and freedom out to be the God of tyranny and oppression, so that we see him as the enemy of our freedom rather than the source of it. But the Bible makes it clear that following Jesus is truly liberating in a way that the world often won't understand, and that Satan does understand but doesn't want us to understand. Paul says in that second reading in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, he says, "For Christ's love compels us." Pause here for a second. Christ's love compels us. Now, if you know this verse, if you've come across this verse in your Bible before, you'll know that not all translations say that word compels. It might say Christ's love constrains us. Both translations kind of fit in their own way. It's this Greek word synecho. It literally just means to take hold of. It's sometimes used when speaking about a prisoner when it uses the word arrested. It arrests us. Christ's love arrests us. It grabs us. It's almost like a straitjacket. That's what Christ's love is like to us. Now, we might hear that and think, is that supposed to be a good thing? Because surely freedom shouldn't be like a straitjacket. It's the complete opposite of that. Freedom shouldn't be being compelled or constrained to do stuff. Freedom is about doing what you want. And this verse also goes on to say, it says that we no longer live for ourselves, but for Jesus. Now, surely this one might say, this is the problem with Christianity. It's forcing you to live for Jesus. Where's the fun in that? How can that be freedom? But you see, what this verse is really speaking about is speaking about the freedom that comes from being in love and in a love relationship. And there's no greater freedom than the freedom that comes from being in love. And you might think of a romantic relationship when it comes to that, or love for a child or a friend or family member, those types of love relationships. But really, all these relationships that we know in life, human relationships, which are good things and gifts from God, they are all just really shadows, or really just pointers to the true love relationship that we were made for. You were created to know, first and foremost, the love of God. The God who sought us when we were strangers, wandering from the fold of God. American author and pastor Tim Keller makes the case that the best freedom in life is in relationship, and that means giving up other freedoms. He says, when you fall deeply in love, you want to please the beloved. You don't wait for the person to ask you to do something for her. You eagerly research and learn every little thing that brings her pleasure. Then you get it for her, even if it costs you money or great inconvenience. Your wish is my command, you feel. And it doesn't feel oppressive at all. From the outside, bemused friends may think she's leading him round the nose, or round by the nose. But from the inside, it feels like heaven. For the Christian, it's the same with Jesus. The love of Christ constrains. It arrests us. It grabs us. It has taken hold of us. And to the world that may look like oppression, and Satan will try and convince us that that's what it is. And when you and I treat our faith as merely a set of rules to follow, or a set of religious activities to go along with, and a bunch of meetings that we have to attend, and a persona that we have to try and put on, and a list of sins that we have to stay away from, if that's all that our faith really is at the core, then we will find ourselves in the wilderness, in those times of temptation, and start to think maybe a life apart from God doesn't seem all that bad after all. Maybe there's no freedom in the Christian faith. It's all out in the world. But when we come to understand this verse in 2 Corinthians 5:14 and 15, when we come to see that it is first and foremost a love relationship with the one who has loved us from before the creation of the world, when the core of our faith is a love relationship with the one who had every reason to abandon us, but instead poured out his love and grace and mercy for us on the cross, if that's what the core of our faith is, then when the wilderness days come, and they will do, and Satan throws at us whatever he can, and he paints the God of life out to be the God of tyranny and oppression, then we will say, if we know this love relationship with Christ, we will say, when Satan tempts me to despair and tells me of the guilt within, upward I look and see him there who made an end to all my sin. Because the sinless Saviour died, my sinful soul is counted free. And as that verse in 2 Corinthians tells us, we know that we are no longer to live for ourselves, but for the one who died for us and was raised again. And as we considered a moment ago, the world will think that's oppression, and Satan will try and convince us that's what it is. But for us, it's heaven. Because knowing Jesus and being known by Jesus is better than all that life can give and all that death can take. And if you're a Christian this day, may I ask you this question? As you look at your Christian life over the last few days and weeks and months, is your Christian life more like a life of slavery or more like a life of freedom? Today, if you're walking in a life of slavery that's not satisfying, may you come back to your first love. Come back to Jesus. Before anything else that consists of living for Jesus and all the things we do in the Christian life, come back to him, because he is greater than anything that this world can offer you. And if you're not a Christian this day, and you've maybe never equated Christianity with freedom before, then know that Jesus came that you may have life, and life to the full, but it's a life that can only be found in him, in a relationship with him, in a relationship where you gain true freedom by setting aside other freedoms, in a true love relationship. Please get in touch with us. Details are below, and we'd love to speak to you more about this Jesus. We're going to close our service just now with a hymn, after which I'll close in prayer. But we're going to close with a hymn that's been quoted in this message, "Come, Thou Fount of Every Blessing," after which I'll pray.
Fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mountain fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Here I raise my Ebenezer, hither by thy help I come, and I hope by thy good safely to arrive at home. Jesus, sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger, interposed his precious blood. To grace how great a debtor, daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy goodness like a fetter bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it for thy courts above. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it for thy courts above.
Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for that last verse that we just heard in that hymn, that we are prone to wander. Just like the Israelites were prone to wander, just like we in our lives can feel these moments of wilderness where we are prone to wander. Father, help us to keep our eyes fixed on the one who loves us, the one who calls us to himself, the one who takes our burdens away from us, the one who took our sin upon his shoulders on the cross and is alive this day and offers us abundant life. Father, help us this day to live for and in Jesus Christ. Forgive us where we fail, where we are tempted by old ways of living. Keep us fixed on Christ, that we would be obedient in lives that honour him. And Father, for those who don't know Jesus this day, who have listened to this message, may you speak to them by the power of your Holy Spirit, speak to their hearts and show them where true freedom is found, not in anything this world can offer, but in a relationship with the God who loves them. We praise you for all your goodness to us. Keep our eyes fixed on you this week, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you all and have a great week. We'll see you next Sunday.